Hey, welcome to the Pastor and the Professor. I'm Bobby E. I'm the pastor. And this is the world famous, world renowned Paul Stewart Evans, my brother, the professor.
Good day.
Good day, except for you, it's good night because it's still light
That's
here.
Right.
What, it's 10:01 your time?
Yeah, just after 10.
Just after 10. Are you worn out yet? 10 p.m.?
Well, I'm a little tired.
Are you a little tired? So
I'm a little tired.
You know, the amount of sleep that you get tonight will kind of depend on how long-winded the pastor and the professor are tonight then.
That's right. We could be up for a while.
We'll keep it down to a minimum. Yeah, yeah. So I got one question for you, Paul, before we bring in Ollie for sports tonight.
All right, what?
How does a university seminary professor work during COVID? It's not a joke. I'm asking.
I haven't been in the office since last March, so I just work at home, do meetings with students on Zoom.
Wow.
I teach on Zoom. I make a lot of online lectures, and all of our meetings are on Zoom. So, yeah, just sit at home by your lonesome. Although, you know, the whole family's home half the time. So.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, you get the family around quite a bit. Are your numbers getting any better with the lockdowns, the circuit breaker?
I haven't
breaker?
Followed it that closely, actually, but the guys I was working with today said that they were finally ticking down a bit today, but it hadn't been ticking down even though we're on lockdown, so yeah, it's been a long haul.
No kidding. Yeah, the numbers are ticking down a little bit in BC now.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, we're holding on to hope. So you've been doing a lot of online stuff too.
Yeah, that's all we've been doing. Yep.
Yeah.
Nothing face to face.
Have you, like me, been getting better at it as the year's gone on?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. There's
a
learning
bit.
Curve and stuff. But
yeah,
it's gotten better. Yeah. I mean, I always was teaching some online before, so I kind of knew some of the basics. But
yeah,
it's gotten better with making the classes better and a better experience for students. So. But nothing beats having some FaceTime together, though. But
Yeah. I can't wait to throw a football with somebody and a frisbee.
Right, yeah.
Yeah. We'll have to throw a frisbee around when you come to visit in BC in August. Hopefully the numbers
will
be good.
Fun.
Yeah. Well, speaking about sports, we got a young man that happens to like them very much. Mr. Oliver Leroy, are you in the house?
Yes, I am.
How are you, young man?
Good, thanks.
Good. Don't let anyone look down on you because you're young. But be an example to everyone.
Well, that's how I am. I try to be at school.
Good man. Good man. So, seeing as that you're a sports guy tonight, what kind of information have you got for us tonight, sir?
Well, the NBA, the Phoenix Suns, make it to the playoffs in the first time since 2010.
Really? Paul, did you know that? Did you know that, Paul?
I did not know that, no.
Yeah.
I wasn't even born.
You weren't even born in 2010.
Oh, wow. You weren't even born. That's crazy.
And here you are, sportscaster for the number one program in North America on Thursday evenings.
You've got quite a career going already.
That's good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So do the Golden State Warriors get to make it to the playoffs this year? I don't know how that works.
I don't know.
Probably not if the Phoenix Suns.
Close. Steph Curry's been on a tear, but he really's got no one else working with him right now.
Oh.
True.
Okay. What about the CFL? You find out any information for me about the Eskimos?
The Eskimos have got potential names for the team.
Okay. All right. What are some of the names that the Eskimos might become?
The Elk, the Eagles, the Elk Hounds. The Elements, Eclipse, and Evergreen.
They're trying to keep that double E as their logo, obviously.
Yes.
Okay, Elements, Eagles,
Elk Hounds, Evergreen, Eclipse, and Elk.
The Edmonton Eclipse, the Edmonton...
I like the Edmonton Eclipse.
You like the Edmonton Eclipse?
I think it sounds good.
What do you think, Paul?
What were they again? Elk Hounds?
The Elk Hounds.
Oh, the Elks.
What else, Ollie? Eagles?
Yep.
Eagles, Elements. Not bad.
Evergreen.
Evergreen. Evergreen. It sounds like a old folks home.
Sounds more like a BC name. There's not a lot of evergreen in Edmonton.
No.
Everwinter.
See, you like the Eclipse, Ollie? Is that your pick?
Yeah.
Paul, I'm going to go for the Edmonton Eagles. Is that what you're going for?
Yeah, I kind of thought that might work. I mean, there's already an Eagles football team in the NFL, but...
True.
Hmm. But there's also Lions in both leagues, so could be.
Detroit Lions, BC Lions, Edmonton Eagles, Philadelphia Eagles, am I right?
Yeah.
What else you got for sports? Well, Ollie, we'll see who gets what name Edmonton picks. If they pick the Eclipse, I will buy you a Slurpee of any size.
Nice.
If they pick the Eagles, you're going to buy me a Slurpee of my choice, right?
Yeah.
Okay. What else you got for us in sports here, big guy?
The Philly star Bryce Harper got hit in the face by a 97-mile baseball.
Wow.
He feels good.
He feels okay? Did it break his nose?
I don't know.
Break his jaw?
There's potential.
Yeah, well, our mom watches baseball. Maybe she got to see that on TV. I don't know. It depends if they're playing the Blue Jays, I guess, eh, Paul?
Yeah. Cool. Is it true that the Leafs made the playoffs? Some guy told me that today, that they clinched a playoff spot.
The Maple Leafs?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They did?
Yeah.
This guy was pretty excited about it. He's from Toronto. He was telling me today.
Well, they've got the Maple Leafs curse.
Oh yeah.
They haven't won a cup for life.
No, I'm not saying they're winning a cup, but they made the playoffs apparently, so.
I'm gonna jinx it because I don't want them to.
No. What do you want? The Vegas Knights to win, get to the cup again?
You're a Habs fan, aren't you?
Yes, I'm a Habs fan.
Yeah. That's right.
Well, there is a Sikkimusian at the head of the Habs there, Captain Shea Weber. So
that's right.
Yeah, I would love to see the Stanley Cup come to Sikkimus for a visit, eh, Ollie? So what else you got for us in the NHL?
Ryan Miller, Ducks veteran goaltender, plans to retire at the end of the season.
Okay, cool. And I heard there's a new Mighty Ducks TV show on Disney Plus.
That is the Game Changers.
Oh, okay. Is that what it's called? Have you seen it?
Yeah. Is no.
No? It's a hockey show. You haven't watched it?
I haven't watched it.
Oh, dude. Okay. Well, that's okay. You're probably watching a Marvel movie or something like that. Cool. Any other NHL news for us, Oliver?
After that, I got an NFL and a CFL thing. But Matthew Barzal, centerman for the New York Islanders, was fined $2,000 for diving.
Oh, wow.
Embellishment.
What's embellishment mean? Sorry, I don't know.
That's a good question.
Okay.
He just hands it up like he got hit really hard and he dived.
Oh, like LeBron does all the time.
He handed that
up. Oh, yeah.
LeBron would be broke, I think.
Like LeBron.
So it's a good thing they don't find LeBron. So he got fined $2,000 for hamming it up. That's hilarious. Okay.
For being a LeBron.
Yeah, for being a LeBron, for embellishment. I get it. Fakery. Okay. And what else you got for us, buddy? You got something in the, what'd you say, the NFL?
And the CFL.
Okay. But what are they?
Vegas won last night, too, against Colorado 5-2.
Okay.
And the NFL draft of 2021 starts May 1st.
Okay.
For first round picks. And the CFL 2021 draft picks start on the 4th. May the 4th be with you.
May the
4th. Star Wars Day.
Star Wars Nice. Day. There you go. Well, may the 4th be with the CFL too. There you go. Yeah, I'm sure anybody that's a CFL fan, like my dad, will be glad to see some football happening there. And yeah, well, any other sports news for us there, Ollie?
All I got.
Okay. Well, Paul, do you got any questions you want Ollie to do some research for us this week? Anything you think of with sports?
Who's got the number one draft pick in the NFL? And who are they going to pick?
I'll get on to that.
Okay, good. And let me know if there's any coaches switching teams for the CFL, buddy.
Okay.
Yeah. Is Pinball Clemens still a coach there, Paul?
I have no idea.
Okay.
I haven't watched CFL in a while.
Okay. Well, there you go. Well, Ollie, your research is impeccable. I thank you for your good work, my friend.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I don't think I'll make you wait till that bet, and then we'll get a Slurpee this week sometime, okay?
Well, there's only one day left in the week, so.
Well, I mean in the next 7 days, you buffoon. You're a good man. Thanks for putting up with us, Ollie, and for doing a good job today, buddy.
Yep, thanks for having me.
Yeah, you have a good night, and enjoy digesting those pancakes.
I will.
Okay, see you, pal. Good job. Bye.
Bye.
Well, there you go. So, I think I hung up with my brother, too. I did. Nuts. Okay, hang on a sec. I'll bring Paul back. Paul started a call. How do I do that? Paul, where are you? I got to learn how to do this. There he is. Sorry, buddy. I thought I was hanging up on Oliver and I hung up on you too. There you go. I still got to learn this fine art of broadcasting. So, Paul, just before we get going on the really interesting topic tonight that we've got to talk about, I thought I'd mention a couple things. We always need something good to watch. And so I've got a trailer for a movie I started watching today, documentary about Jeremy Lin. You know who that is?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Linsanity.
Yeah, Linsanity. So this is the trailer for Linsanity, a great documentary movie about Jeremy Lin. He's a Christian, and this is his story. And if you message me later, I'll send you the link on YouTube to watch it. Here's the trailer.
Some of those experiences out there when I was on the court, I felt like I was being controlled by something else. I felt like I was having an out-of-body experience. I still have to pinch myself. Some of those experiences out there when I was on the court, I felt like I was being controlled by something else. I felt like I was having an out-of-body experience. I still have to pinch myself to really believe it.
Wait a minute, who's this kid?
Already cut twice this season.
Wait, not drafted? Wait.
Nobody thought he could play.
Sleeping on a teammate's couch.
Jeremy Lin came from nothing to greatness.
I don't think you have to be a sports fan to hear about this story.
You will. Linsanity takes New York by storm.
I didn't want to play the piano. Like every year, the recital would come around and I'd be pretty much playing the same song. And they're just like, this is not working. All he does is play basketball. So let's just let him play basketball.
And he's just this little kid. It just scored the basketball so well.
In high school, Jeremy was the best player here.
And Lin is going to have to launch a 25-footer. And
did he call that?
But yet, colleges weren't clamoring for him. He just didn't fit the mold.
People look at basketball players in terms of race.
College, it just got crazy.
Can you even open your eyes? Can you see the scoreboard?
I was really interested in seeing if a team would take the plunge and take this Asian American player.
If I don't get drafted here, I probably won't get drafted.
Landry Fields.
He puts the order of God first, family second, basketball third. It's more of God is in all those things.
He's standing at the door and he had tears in his eyes because the pressure was really getting to him. And I remember he turned to me and he says, I don't know if I can keep doing this.
You don't get better if you win all the time. You look at yourself more when you lose.
Lin has a chance to make history as the first Asian American NBA player in the modern era.
This transcends sports.
That's all I dream about is hitting the game winner and then doing some clothes and then walking off.
Puts it up! Bang! Jeremy Lin from downtown!
You know, that's like all I did growing up. I wanted to know what that felt like.
Send it to you early.
That movie is worth watching, folks. You want to see a true story about a great basketball player who's got a real solid faith. Watch Linsanity. And so gives you something good to watch, something inspirational. I love a good true story, Paul. I love a Rocky story sort of where there's a really good player, you know, when he's not, nobody knows him, and then he comes out of nowhere. great.
Yeah, that's a pretty good story.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. Yeah. It's kind of like the Bible in a lot of ways, because the Bible's always displaying a character who comes from behind. Yeah,
there's lots of that.
Yeah,
for sure.
I love it. So tonight we have a fascinating topic, and it is, the ad that I put on Instagram. I don't know if what you think about this, but I call this talk tonight, Paul, "How God Works Out His Plan Through the Bad Guys." Is that sort of an okay for the topic we're discussing tonight?
Maybe. It's one direction you could go if you think of providence or something like that. Yeah.
A little bit. There you go. So it's, one thing about the Bible that I love is that it's always stretching my mind. It's always, you can't put God in a box. You see the amazing things he does, and he's always kind of blowing away preconceptions, but he's also... what Rick McKinley, one of my favorite pastors, says is he's got this sweet judo move on evil. And judo, you use evil's momentum the bad guy's momentum against themselves, right? And
right.
That kind of thing. So, yeah, that's what we're talking about tonight. Cool. Yeah, and you sent me a couple passages, and I've got them organized, and tonight they're actually labeled. So I cannot get lost, right, when I'm putting them up there. Since we're going to be looking at the Word of God, why don't I pray real quick, and then we'll pull them up and we'll go over them. Sound good?
Sounds good. Sounds great.
Okay. Lord, give us your mental sharpness tonight and your Spirit's insight. And I pray that what we learn would equip us, Lord. And you bless Paul as he talks about your Word, and me as well, Lord, and all of us that are interacting with this. Thank you, Lord, that you're with us at the end of a long day and a week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So I've got here, Paul, the verse on the screen is 1 Samuel 5:3. Okay, so I'll read it, and then you can kind of give some background. Does that sound good?
Sure. Sounds good.
Okay, so the citizens of Ashdod, is that a city in Philistia?
Yeah, it's one of the major five Philistine cities. Yeah.
Okay. When the citizens of Ashdod went to see the ark the next morning, what's the ark?
So the context of the story is, in the previous chapter, Israel had brought the Ark of the Covenant, from Raiders of the Lost Ark, Indiana Jones. It's basically this box overlaid with gold with some cherubim on top that symbolized God's presence in Israel.
Okay.
And so the Israelites had brought it to battle because they thought it'd be a good luck charm, that if they had the ark, it's kind of like in Indiana Jones, actually, that when they introduce the ark, they say any army that has the ark would be invincible.
Yes.
But the Bible proves that this is not true, because the Israelites bring the ark to battle thinking that that'll make God help make them win the battle. And they lose the battle terribly, and the Philistines actually steal the ark, which is kind of wild. And this chapter is when the ark is in the Philistine territory. This is a rather odd chapter because it's just all about the Philistines.
Okay, and they take the ark to Ashdod.
Yeah.
Okay, so here we go. When the citizens of Ashdod went to see the ark the next morning, their trophy, I guess, Dagon, their god, had fallen with his face to the ground in front of the ark of the Lord. So they took Dagon and they put him in his place again. Next verse says this. But the next morning, the same thing happened. Dagon had fallen face down before the ark of the Lord again. This time his head and hands had broken off and were lying in the doorway. Only the trunk of his body was left intact. That is why to this day neither the priests of Dagon nor anyone who enters the temple of Dagon in Ashdod will step on its threshold. Next verses. Then the Lord's hand was heavy and struck the people of Ashdod and the nearby villages with a plague of tumors. When the people realized what was happening, they cried out, "We can't keep the ark of the God of Israel here any longer. He is against us. We will all be destroyed with Dagon, our God." And then it says this, "Help, Who can save us from these mighty gods of Israel? They are the same gods who destroyed the Egyptians with plagues when Israel was in the wilderness. Fight as never before, Philistines. If you don't, we will become the Hebrew slaves just as they have been ours. Stand up like men and fight. Very okay, interesting story. I think those
two verses are out of order.
Okay, sorry.
Like the one speech there about them fighting.
Oh, yeah?
That takes place before they steal the ark. That's when they're fighting the Israelites.
Oh, okay. So I messed that up. Sorry about that. Okay. So they said, fight like never before, or they're saying, we have to beat the Israelites. They steal the ark?
Yeah.
Okay. Gotcha.
Well, okay. It's interesting, though, actually, in the first passage. So is the one is from chapter 4, I think, then, is it?
Okay. It must have been. I thought it was 5:8. It's all good.
Well, the first part about Dagon falling down and all that is in chapter 5.
Yes. Okay.
Where was that?
So 5:3.
This is you were reading actually 4.
Okay.
5. So actually, what they do is they freak out when the Israelites bring the ark into the camp. The Philistines are freaked out and they actually say, "Oh no." They brought a god into their camp.
Right.
They don't really understand.
They think the ark is the god of Israel.
Yeah. But it's interesting, actually, the part you read, I think you read verse 8, where they say, who can deliver us from the power of these mighty gods?
Yep.
They say, these are the gods who struck the Egyptians with every sort of plague in the wilderness. Well, if you know the story of the Exodus, the plagues take place in Egypt.
In Egypt.
And then they move to the wilderness, right? So, but it's interesting that the Philistines have heard the Exodus story.
Right.
They just have some of the details mixed up.
Yes. Gotcha. Wow.
So then they take the ark and it's captured. And when it's in their temple, the temple of Dagon, they come in and, you know, Dagon's fallen down. And I think it's hilarious. The second time they come in and Dagon was trying to escape. He just got as far as the door and then fell apart. I just think it's kind of funny.
It's a great image, yeah. Dagon, doesn't he? Yeah, he's a funny looking god too. I saw some drawings of what Dagon looked like. They're idol,
right.
Yeah.
It's like a fish god, right?
Yeah.
It's always kind of funny. I always joke about in Hebrew that dog is fish, because the word dog means fish in Hebrew.
Oh, that's hilarious. Yeah. That's funny.
Out of it, they like my dad jokes. But anyway, this is actually interesting that why would God let the Philistines take the ark?
Yeah, capture the ark, yeah.
Right? Well, we already know they have some knowledge of the God of Israel. They're pretty mixed up about it, though. But they've heard about how he plagued the Egyptians. They think it happened in a wilderness. But
yeah,
why would God let them take it? Now, it's clear Israel needed to learn a lesson because they thought they could manipulate God into helping them in the battle.
Yeah.
When they actually were into idolatry at the time, the priests that brought the ark, Hophni and Phinehas, were wicked priests who were stealing the meat of the sacrifices from the people who were sacrificing, taking the best prime cuts of beef. And they were actually even sleeping with the women who came to serve at the sanctuary.
Horrible men. We learned about that in
the previous chapter. So God said he was going to punish the house of Eli, and Hophni and Phinehas are his sons.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of the context. Israel's sin is why they lost the ark. But you still might wonder, why would he let the ark go into Philistine territory?
It's a good question.
And the reference to the Exodus is kind of interesting because, you know, if you read the Exodus story, what was the purpose of all those plagues? I mean, clearly the plagues are what lead the Pharaoh to let the Israelites go.
Mm-hmm.
But if you read the Exodus story, actually, the plagues are actually supposed to be a source of revelation for the Egyptians. Because it says over and over, then they will know that I am Yahweh, I am the God. So on all the plagues, it's always like, then they will know. Right? And God actually says he's come to cast judgment on the gods of Egypt.
Right.
So he's actually trying to teach Egypt that he's the true God in the Exodus story.
Mm-hmm.
So when we come to this Philistine story, I think it's very similar to God is actually trying to communicate to the Philistines. And I think that's the best reason I can come up with as to why they have the ark there.
Hmm.
But what's really odd is, in order to teach them that he's the real God, it's weird how God works through their pagan rituals. This is what I think is pretty fascinating. So how do they send the ark back? Did you have the verses on that one?
I didn't because I had the wrong chapter, apparently. Okay, I can read them for you, though, if you tell me what they are. Excuse me.
Right, and...
been talking too much today.
Oh, no problem. So in chapter 6...
Mm-hmm. 1 Samuel 5, 6?
Yeah. So verse 2, and we could read down to... well, verse 7, really, but we could read it in parts if it's too long to read all at once. But
well, I'll just read it.
It's kind of fascinating stuff.
They carried the Ark of God into the temple of Dagon, placed it beside the idol of Dagon. But that's when they went back to see it the next morning. And it says that they...
Yeah, that's chapter 5, right?
Yep. You want chapter 5?
Chapter 6, sorry.
Chapter 6. Okay, chapter 6. Here we go. Welcome to live... This is what life is like with Bob Evans when it's live, folks. You get the real deal. First, chapter 6. Then the Philistines called in their priests and diviners and asked them, "What should we do about the Ark of the Lord? Tell us how to return it to its own country. Send the Ark of the God of Israel back with a gift," they were told. "Send a guilt offering so the plague will stop," because they got tumors, right? So
yeah.
Then if you are healed, you will know it was his hand that caused the plague. "What sort of guilt offering should we send?" the Philistines asked. And they were told, "Since the plague has struck you, both you and your five rulers, make 5 gold tumors and 5 gold rats, just like those that have ravaged your land. Make sure these things are to show honor to the God of Israel. Perhaps then he will stop afflicting you, your gods, and your land. Don't be stubborn and rebellious as Pharaoh and the Egyptians were." By the time God had finished with them, they were eager to let Israel go. "Now build a new cart, find 2 cows that have just given birth to calves. Make sure the cows have never been yoked to a cart. Hitch the cows to the cart, shut the calves away from them in a pen, put the Ark of the Lord on the cart, and beside it place a chest containing the 5 gold rats and the gold tumors you are sending them as a guilt offering. Then let the cows go wherever they want."
Like, it's weird. Okay, so, I mean, the plagues are weird anyway. So, mm-hmm. It says they get tumors, hey?
Yeah.
And so some people think it's bubonic plague. It's
right.
Buboes. And maybe that's why they make models of rats as well. Mm. A lot of scholars think it actually means hemorrhoids.
Oh, boy.
Which is kind of funny because, you know, in Spielberg's Raiders of the Lost Ark, when you're exposed to the Ark, your face melts off.
But yeah.
In reality, it's your other end that gets plagued.
Oh, boy.
Anyway, but it might be that it's bubonic plague or something like that. Mm. But what I think is weird is their diviners, their pagan priests, come up with this plan. How are we going to know if Yahweh is the true God?
Yeah.
You remember, they're already calling it the Ark of the Lord now. Lord in all capitals in the Old Testament, in the English translation, is the word Yahweh. So. Yeah. They say, "What shall we do with the Ark of Yahweh?" And they come up with this plan. "Well, we will make golden tumors and golden rats and send them as an offering."
Yeah.
Well, this is basically like sympathetic magic, you know, like voodoo dolls. If you have a doll that kind of symbolizes someone,
you
do something and it affects the real world. And
yeah.
So they're thinking, if we make models of our tumors, it'll... somehow please God and make this go away. I mean, that's weird. How do you make a model of a tumor?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
But anyway. So this is just a total pagan practice. And then they come up with this test where they're like, "We'll put the Ark on this cart with these cows that have recently given birth and they've never pulled a cart before. If they go all the way to Israel, we'll know it's truly God." And, you know, it would be a miracle because those cows would want to go be with their young. They've just
given birth.
And the plan works. That's what I think is weird, is God kind of stooped to their level with this kind of pagan superstitious practices.
Mm.
So he so much wanted to reveal himself to them and let them know he's the true God that he lets all that work. He works within that.
Mm.
That's kind of weird. That's kind of wild.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's kind of like God's almost like letting a little fishing line out and reeling them in a little bit. Okay.
kind of cool. Meets them where they are,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And it's interesting, though, like, compared to Israel, if you read the earlier story, like I said, the Eliad house is being judged, Hophni and Phinehas. Mm-hmm. Prophet had come to Eli and said that he wasn't honoring God. Hmm. And the word for honor in Hebrew, kavod, is the same word as to be heavy.
Hmm.
And the prophet makes a pun. He says, you haven't honored God. Instead, you've honored your son, and you've gotten fat on all these sacrifices you've been stealing.
Mm-hmm.
And in the end, Eli is said to be heavy or kavod.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of why he dies when he falls over.
Mm-hmm.
So, but here, the Philistines actually say they want to honor God. In verse 5 there, they say, give glory. The same word as kavod is glory or honor. So unlike the Israelites, who weren't concerned with honoring God, they just wanted to kind of manipulate God by using the ark.
Yep.
Here the Philistines actually want to give glory to God.
They say, make now, these things to show honor.
Way.
Yeah.
But yeah. Sorry, I missed what you said.
They say, make these things to show honor to the God of Israel.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Some translations there will say glory because it's the same word, honor.
Okay.
But yeah. Hmm. So that's what they're actually up to. So God works through all that, and he leads obviously these cows. They bring the ark all the way back to Israel, and they see what's going on. They're watching covertly to see what happens. So I just think it's wild that God is working through some pagan practices to give them a hint of who he is.
Mm-hmm.
So they learn the fear of God to start because, you know, Dagon's falling over, they're plagued, and it says that they're afraid. And you know what Proverbs says, that the fear of God is the beginning of knowledge,
mm-hmm.
the beginning of wisdom. So it's kind of the first step towards realizing who God is actually to fear him first.
Mm.
So he's leading them along. He's giving them some revelation there. And so I think just like the plagues in Egypt, the point of the ark going there is actually to reach out to the Philistines.
Hmm. Wow.
Yeah.
So God's reaching out even to the villains.
Yeah. For sure. God, in the Old Testament and the New Testament, is concerned with the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
It really is. I mean, Israel's supposed to be a kingdom of priests. Priests don't serve themselves. They serve non-priests, right? They're supposed to be a nation to reach the world. God's always been concerned with the whole world. Mm-hmm. But there's that one other passage in chapter 28. Do we want to check that one out?
Yeah, yeah. And I hope I got this one right. I think I do. Okay. So here we go. The witch of Endor said to Saul, whose spirit do you want me to call up? Call up Samuel, Saul replied. When the woman saw Samuel coming up out of the ground, she screamed, you deceived me. You are Saul. And then it says, don't be afraid, the king told her. What do you see? I see a spirit coming up out of the earth. She said, what does he look like? Saul asked. He is an old man wrapped in a robe, she replied. Saul realized it was Samuel, and he fell to the ground before him. Whoa. That's a funky set of verses.
This is a bizarre, bizarre chapter. I think it's one of the weirdest scenes in the whole Bible.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a seance that happens, it seems.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like it works. It seems like a prophet of God comes back from the dead on request of this old woman or this medium or witch.
Mm-hmm.
And that's weird. That's wild. There's some debate over how to interpret this passage. Some think that she's just kind of like a charlatan. You know, she's just kind of making this stuff up. After all, when Saul shows up, one of Saul's characteristics in the book of Samuel is he's a head taller than anyone else in Israel.
Right.
So when he shows up, some think, well, she probably figured out it was Saul right away. He's so tall. And after all, why did she say, you lied, you're Saul? How did she know he was Saul all of a sudden just because this apparition was coming up?
Mm.
So some think that the lady is kind of out. This is what charlatans do, right? They, people who claim to work with spirits of the dead, they often, they take what they know about the audience, they take what they know about the one who's passed away, and they mm-hmm. make stuff up.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems pretty clear that only she sees Samuel, right? So Saul is like, what do you see? What do you see? And she says, oh, I see this. and he figures it out. And it could be she's doing the talking for Samuel too, some think, right? Mm. So if that was the case, this would just be her fooling Samuel.
Yeah.
But I don't think that that's true, because the text actually says, "And Samuel said." So the narrator seems to be saying Samuel's actually there. So
yes.
It could be that this is actually Samuel. It seems that way.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when she sees him, it says she actually screams, right? She freaks
She's
out.
She's freaked out. Yeah.
So it could be that she doesn't normally get this kind of results in her practice, right?
Wow,
so
yeah.
She's freaked out too.
Mm-hmm.
And then Samuel comes in and gives one last prophecy. And he's basically saying the same kind of thing he said all along, that Saul, you rejected. God is now fulfilling what I said, what God had told me to tell you. But what I think is weird is, again, God seems to be working through a pagan practice to reveal himself.
Hmm.
I think this is really weird. This is even weirder than the other one.
Yeah.
Like Saul, if you read the story of Saul, you see that he's really into getting some kind of superstitious or ritualistic assurance of success throughout the whole story. And so now God's not answering him because he's in rebellion against God and disobeys every time he's told something.
Mm-hmm.
And Saul even went out and slaughtered all the priests of God at Nob. So when he's asking for a word from God, he's getting nothing. So he finally decides, well, then I need to go see a medium, a witch.
He's that desperate.
He's so desperate, yeah. But, you know, God didn't have to still give him a word here. Why does he do it?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's wild, but God does. He condescends and he sends Samuel for one more word towards Saul, and which just confirms that the word of God is going to come through. And it's really weird in this passage. This woman, I almost feel kind of sorry for her. I mean, she's a pagan medium, but if you look at what she does after she freaked out, for one thing,
yeah,
and then she's actually being betrayed. Earlier in the chapter, we're told that Saul had kicked out all the mediums and wizards out of Israel.
Mm-hmm.
And then so when she realizes it's Saul, she's like, I'm going to get killed for this, aren't I?
Yeah.
But Saul, it's actually very sad how messed up Saul is. Saul actually swears by Yahweh's name that no harm will come to her.
Mm-hmm.
So he's so into swearing and vowing. And so he swears in the name of God that this woman won't be punished for actually breaking the law of God, because mediums and wizards are disallowed. So he's saying you won't be punished even though you deserve to. And he swears by Yahweh. So that's a pretty serious thing.
Mm-hmm.
But then, so the woman screams when she sees Samuel. The message is relayed. And then at the end, she actually seems like she's a decent gal. You know, Saul is starving. He's been fasting. And she says, oh, let me get you something to eat. And she makes him a meal, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of interesting. So it's almost a sympathetic portrayal. Maybe God is also reaching out to the medium in this story as well. But he for sure is reaching out to Saul, and he does through this kind of pagan practice, which is wild. I have a quote from an early church father, John Chrysostom,
mm-hmm.
and he writes about this passage. He says this: the heathen only believe in predictions of their kind of mantic, so God makes use of it in order to reach them, however abominable pagan mantic is to him.
Hmm.
So in his view, he's thinking, this was a way God could reach them, because they only really believe in these kind of superstitious things. So God actually, in this instance, uses that to reach out to them.
Hmm.
I don't know. What do you think?
Well, it's interesting. While you're talking, it made me think of Sundar Singh, and he was a Sikh that was totally depressed and found no fulfillment in his Sikh religion. And one night he talked to God and he said, God, if you're real, whoever you are, you need to reveal yourself to me, because I'm going to kill myself tomorrow.
Wow.
And that night, a light was burning in his room, and he thought it was coming from the other house that must have been on fire or something. It woke him. And it was a theophany, a appearance of Jesus. And Jesus said, I'm the God you've been looking for. He became a Christian and became a traveling evangelist for wow. the Christian faith and has written many books. And here's the guy that really didn't know anything about Jesus Christ or the Judeo-Christian religion at all.
Right.
Wow. And you know, prayed the only way he knew how, and God revealed himself.
Yeah.
And changed his life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's amazing. Well, I've heard stories of a lot of people in the Muslim world who had visions of Jesus and come to the faith through that.
Yeah.
But I think it's just wild. And to me, it almost seems wrong. If I was going to be really conservative, it's wrong that God does this.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't think God does anything wrong. So I'm just kind of saying.
Yeah.
But that's my first impression of this, is how could he work through this? Like, in my little box that I have God in,
yes.
I wouldn't think that God would ever do something like this.
Mm-hmm.
But, well, he does. And it's right there in Scripture. Samuel himself shows up and gives a prophetic word to Saul.
Hmm. Yeah, that's just a wild story. And I'm guessing, Paul, that you're right, that this lady's life was changed, irrevocably changed after this. I think that she's probably smartened up.
And she heard the word of the Lord proclaimed, and everyone would know the next day that it came true, because Saul was killed and the whole land knows it. So it came to fulfillment. What's interesting, I sometimes think of, is this isn't even just the Old Testament. In the New Testament, mm-hmm. who are those guys who brought the gold, frankincense, and myrrh?
Who are
those guys?
Were they astrologers, the wise men?
They're like pagan astrologers. They're called magi in Greek. You know, a magus is a magician.
Yeah, right? Wow. I didn't know that.
Pagan astrologers.
Hmm.
And magi is the plural of magus.
Wow.
Like, God used their astrology, apparently, to lead them to Christ.
You are saying bright new star. Let me guess.
Yeah. Let's follow the star. Something important there. And then they learn, of course, from the scriptures, from the Jews in Jerusalem, or about how the Messiah is going to be born, and they're led to Christ. But it seems like God used their pagan astrology to reach them. That's another instance where God works within this kind of superstitious practice.
Wild stuff, man. Kind of
wild, yeah.
Huh.
So like you said at the beginning, God isn't in a box. He can't stay in this little box where we have all the answers, because there's some mysterious stuff in the Old Testament and in Scripture overall.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Huh. And you know, this isn't as wild a way, but I remember a guy named Peter, you and I both know him. And NFL football games, a lot of times you'll see a guy with a placard that says John 3:16.
Right. Yeah.
And you see Steve Taylor's got a great song about it called Banner Man, right? So the guy's got a banner, says John 3:16. He's holding up, he's in the end zone behind the uprights. So when the field goal goes in, he holds up his sign, says John 3:16. Well, Peter's watching an NFL game on a motel TV and notices the Banner Man. It says John 3:16. Game finishes, shuts it off, goes to put his wallet in the nightstand next to his bed. There's a Bible from the Gideons. Opens it up to John 3:16. Comes to believe Jesus is the Savior of the world and gets saved.
Wow, that's crazy, eh?
Yeah, it's cool. I tell that to my Gideon friends. They're now called Share Word Globally because, I mean, that's just, there's this guy down in Kentucky holding up a sign saying John 3:16, and the Lord puts it all together. And I think that the cool thing about all of this is that, like you said, God's even reaching out to the people that we would consider to be villains.
And
he's a God of grace. And, you know, Peter wrote, it's his desire that none should perish, but all should come to repentance. And to think that he's reaching out to the Philistines, and man, I don't know what psalm it was, Paul, because I've been going through the Psalms in the morning, but I love the one psalm I read where it said that the people in Philistia will be my people,
right.
And the people in Egypt will be my people, and it's just, it's a pretty cool concept to think that God loves the world and he's after everybody, and he's gonna, he was even gave that Witch of Endor a chance to be saved, a medium, somebody, yeah, you know, to come to him to be a follower of Yahweh. So yeah, it's a fascinating subject, man. I love it.
Yeah, there's a passage in Isaiah that talks about how Assyria and Egypt will become like Israel to him. He says, "Blessed be Egypt, my people, and Assyria, the work of my hands, and Israel, my heritage." And Assyria and Egypt are two of the big baddies in their in the history of Israel, right? Like, yeah, like God has redemptive plans for everybody. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, Nineveh was in Assyria, right? The city?
Yeah, that was the capital. Yeah.
And when Jonah preached to them, like 165,000 people were saved. Billy Graham says it was the greatest revival in history in a city. That many people all came at once to repentance. And there's the Assyrians. And again, God blew away Jonah's box. And Jonah hated them so bad. And here God was reaching out to the Assyrians, the Ninevites.
Yeah, no, it's amazing. And it's wild to me to think that God might use some kind of pagan practices today to reach these people too, right? Mm. But God cares about them. I mean, in one sense, God hates false religion because it's leading people astray. But in another way, he works through everything, right? His own purposes. So yeah, even in some kind of pagan practices, God could work through them. I'm not trying to say all religions lead to the same place or they're all great or anything like that. But yeah, I can't put God in this box to say he couldn't work through someone's faith to reach out. Yeah. And lead them to Christ, right? Yeah. Lead them to truth. That's what he wants to do. But yeah, it's wild.
Yeah, something else. And you know, when you think about in the Bible where the Lord says, if you seek me with your whole heart, you'll find me. And I believe that there's one of the reasons, for instance, that there's reports of thousands of Muslims having theophany visions of Jesus talking to them, or and they're becoming Christians, is because they want to know God, and they're, you know, the Lord's after them for sure. It's all prevenient grace or whatever the word is, but the Lord's after people, and he knows their hearts too. And if they're digging for gold, a lot of times God's so gracious he lets us find the gold through the graces that he gives, the red crumbs towards him, right?
Yeah,
that's so wild. So I guess we should try not to put God in a box and just pray for people that we know to know Jesus and to find the one true God, and just also thank the Lord for this amazing, fascinating, amazing Bible that we all have.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's amazing. It really is to think that God could be working in all these different weird ways today too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's fascinating, and what a great God that he is. He's not above trying everything, like, to reach people, right? That he loves us so much.
Yeah. And just as a disclaimer, folks, please don't ever go use a Ouija board or read the horoscopes or anything to try to find God. God has revealed himself indeed in a book that's the best-selling book of all time, best-selling book every year, the Bible. So if you want to know him and you haven't got a Bible, we got lots at the Hub. So send me a private message and we'll definitely get you a Bible. And I've got one that is called How to Find God, and it will help you get to know him, because the Word of God is so wonderful to have. And there's even 30 pages at the beginning that will teach you how to read the Bible to get to know him. So,
and absolutely the consistent message in the Bible is that pagan religion is leading people astray. It's not helping them, right? Like, mm-hmm. the Deuteronomy is very clear on all this stuff and idolatry. But it's just amazing that God still tries. He works things. So, but it's definitely not recommended. Like, oh, that's an option to learn something about God. Not at all.
No.
But nothing stops God from reaching out to people.
Amazing grace. That's why it's called amazing, eh?
Yep.
That's exactly. Good. Why don't you pray for us, Paul, and then I got an album to tell us about as we leave tonight.
All right. Heavenly Father, thanks so much for your amazing word. Thanks for drawing us to yourself through your Spirit. Thanks that we can know you through your Son, who you sent to die for us and rise from the dead. Thanks for your Spirit that indwells us. And God, we pray for salvation for those who don't know you. We pray for a revival, and we pray for Canada, for people to come to Christ through everything that's happening. Through, we know that you're a God who wants everyone to repent and come to know you. And we pray, God, that more and more would come to know you, to whom to know is eternal life. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thanks, Paul. It was fascinating to even learn about the Magi. So what's that word in Greek? Magus?
Oh, magus is magus. A singular, and magi is plural. Yeah.
It's, and that's
like a magician.
Magician. That's much. Wild. Yeah. That's just wild. Well, tonight I just wanted to tell folks there's a great new album out. You can get it on Spotify, Apple Music. You can even order the CD if you're old school like me. And my mom and dad got it too. And it's I saw Carrie Underwood's performance with CC Winans on the American Country Music Awards. And it was from her new album, My Savior. And it's a wonderful album with some beautiful hymns. So if you want to hear something that's going to bless your heart and build your faith up, go to your favorite streaming service right now. And you can even listen to the whole thing on YouTube. And type in My Savior, Carrie Underwood, and listen to that great CD album of hymns. And the hymns get old. And you can tell the way she sings them that it really means a lot to her. And I tell you, you want to see something cool, Google the Country Music Award. Go to YouTube and type in Carrie Underwood, CC Winans, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Oh, wow. Anyway, cool.
Great hymn. So there's some music for you. And if you want a link to watch Linsanity, that movie testimony about Jeremy Lin in the NBA, let me know and I'll message you the link on YouTube. You can watch it on there. But yeah, we'll leave you tonight with a glimpse of the Carrie Underwood album. And Paul and I are glad you joined us. Thanks, Paul, for being here, buddy.
Hey, thanks for having me. Thanks for being there.
God bless, folks.
God bless.
Some of those experiences out there, when I was on the court, I felt like I was being controlled by something else. I felt like I was having it out of.
This album is one that I have always wanted to make. This is legacy stuff to me. I feel like at the heart of it all is an album like this one. When thinking about making an album like this, one thing I definitely wanted to do was to do the familiar. I wanted to do the traditional songs that I grew up singing. The songs on this album are literally songs that I've heard since birth. We had our little church, we kind of went to a couple. My first one probably would have been just very tiny, wooden pews. It was probably the first place that I sang as well, was in church, singing these hymns in the congregation, as well as being on stage and singing in front of people. It was always just familiar. These songs are like a warm hug, you know, just familiar and sweet, and songs I've been singing my whole life. Hymns and gospel music shaped me as an artist because those were the first things that I sang. I think that was just a great foundation for me now as an artist. One thing that I noticed with making the Christmas album and making this album is, like, you have been singing these songs your whole life, but have you ever really sang them by yourself? I quickly recognized that this is gonna be tougher than I thought it was gonna be. In the year of 2020, it was just such a blessing to get to make both of those albums. I wanted to work with David Garcia on this project. We're familiar with each other. We've worked together making Cry Pretty. I feel like we grew up kind of the same way, and he would understand the intention behind these songs, and the heart behind it was the most important thing, and how it makes you feel when you hear it, and he's just really good at that. I want it to appeal to the people like me who grew up singing these songs, but also we'll be introducing these songs to a whole new generation as well. When you think about the meaning behind Easter, it is about so much thankfulness to Jesus. You know, that is what this album is about. Just what a joy it's been to make music like this right now.